Very good morning, dear students. So today's topic of discussion is antiemetics part 1. The part 2 of the topic shall be covered on Saturday. In today's topic, we shall be covering a brief introduction to the pathophysiology of vomiting. We shall be looking into the classification of antiemetic drugs, and we shall be discussing the pharmacology of some classes of antiemetic drugs. Now, all of you know that vomiting can occur because of a number of reasons. This could be either diseases like gastroenteritis, or it could be due to drugs, toxins, certain hormonal influences, or it could be because of some unpleasant sights which may trigger vomiting. Now, the vomiting is caused because of the stimulation of the vomiting center, which is situated in the medulla oblongata. So you can see this figure. This is the medulla oblongata and this is the vomiting center. There are multiple pathways which reach the vomiting center, and that can elicit the vomiting by stimulating it. Chemoreceptor trigger zone, you can see chemoreceptor trigger zone and nucleus tractus solitarius, that is abbreviated as NTS. These are the two important relay areas that relay impulses from other areas to the vomiting center. So you have to remember the main center for vomiting is vomiting center VC, located in the medulla oblongata, and there are two relay areas, that is nucleus tractus solitarius and the chemoreceptor trigger zone, which relay signals to the VC. There are other relay areas also, like the cortex and the cerebellum, but the principal relay areas are the CTZ and the nucleus tractus solitarius. Of this, one thing that you have to remember here is that CTZ, it is not covered by the blood-brain barrier. Though it is located in the central nervous system, it is not covered by the blood-brain barrier. So all the toxins, all the drugs, etc., which are there in the blood, they can actually send impulses directly to the chemoreceptor trigger zone because they are not, it is not covered by the blood-brain barrier. Now, what are the different types of impulses that reach the vomiting center? So we shall have a look at those. So first and foremost, there are impulses from the periphery, for example, the GIT or the pharynx, and these reach the vomiting center through the chemoreceptor trigger zone or the nucleus tractus solitarius. So you can always feel that if you tickle the pharynx, you may get a gag reflex. Okay, you can get a sensation of vomiting. So these impulses from the pharynx, from the throat, and even the GIT is carried to the VC through the NTS and the chemoreceptor trigger zone. That is the first one you can see here. The next one are the impulses from the blood, and these impulses from the blood, they can actually reach because of the various types of drugs, toxins, hormones. You can see some examples here, levodopa, apomorphine. These are all drugs which can cause vomiting, and these are present in the blood, and they can directly reach the BC through the chemoreceptor trigger zone. I told you the chemoreceptor trigger zone is not bounded by the blood-brain barrier. So all these drugs which are there in the blood, they can directly send impulses to the chemoreceptor trigger zone. And through the chemoreceptor trigger zone, they can actually stimulate the VC to cause vomiting. Then an important category of drugs, that is the cytotoxic drugs and even the radiation therapy and some kind of GI irritants, they can cause the release of the serotonin from the enterochromaffin cells in the gut, and these convey impulses to the chemoreceptor trigger zone and the nucleus tractus solitarius through the vagal efferents in the gut, and they in turn they will stimulate the VC. So here the main the transmitter is the serotonin, but there are other transmitters also. For example, the substance P, which can be released from the gut, and they can stimulate the CTZ and the NTS, and then indirectly it can stimulate the VC. So this is a third stigma pathway. So you can see the first one from the pharynx and the throat, the second one directly from the blood, third one because of GI irritation or some chemotherapy or radiation therapy, which causes the release of serotonin and other mediators like substance P from the gut. The fourth one is the impulses that are coming from the vestibular apparatus in the ear. And these are relayed to the vomiting center through the cerebellum. You can see there is a cholinergic link is there. You can see there's a histaminergic link as well as a cholinergic link, M, muscarinic receptors and histaminergic receptors. So whenever the body is in the motion, so you can have or you change the equilibrium of the inner ear. So what will happen? You can get a feeling of vomiting. That is what happens during motion sickness when you're traveling. So this impulses from the inner ear or the vestibular apparatus of the inner ear, it is carried to the VC through the cerebellum, and it is mainly through a cholinergic link or a histaminergic link. And the last one is the impulses that are reaching the VC from the cortex. So any unpleasant sight or a smell, it can also cause vomiting. And these are actually sensed by the higher centers of the brain, that is the cortex. And the message is then transmitted to the vomiting center, which can cause vomiting. So you can see that a number of receptors are present on the vomiting center. Can and on even on the nucleus tractus solitarius and also on the chemoreceptor trigger zone. So which are the receptors? These are the serotonin receptors, that is a 5-HT3 receptor, D2 receptor, muscarinic receptors, histaminergic receptors, neurokinin 1 receptor. Neurokinin 1 receptors are the receptors which are stimulated by the substance P. Okay, and you also have got cannabinoid receptors, opioid receptors and all present on the chemoreceptor trigger zone and nucleus tractus solitarius. Now, why are these receptors important? These are important because by blocking these receptors, we can actually inhibit the vomiting impulses. So these receptors are very important because when you see the classification of drugs, you will see that all the drugs that we are going to discuss in the under the anti-emetic class of drugs will be blocking one or more of these receptors. So remember the receptors, these are mainly 5-HT3 receptors, D2 receptors, muscarinic receptors, histaminergic receptors, and even the neurokinin 1 receptors, opioid receptors, and even the cannabinoid receptors. Okay, with that introduction, we'll move to the definition of anti-emetic drugs. These are the drugs which are used to either prevent or to suppress vomiting. Now, how do we classify antiemetic? This is the first and the foremost important question from the examination point of view. So we classify them as follows. Anticholinergic. So I told you already there is a muscarinic receptor. So anticholinergics. Examples are hyoscine, dicyclomine. Then H1 antihistaminics. Examples. Promethazine, diphenhydramine, dimenhydrinate, doxylamine, meclizine. These you have already studied in your chapter on antihistaminics. Then neuroleptics. These you have not covered so far. These are the neuroleptics and these mainly block the D2 receptors. And they include chlorpromazine, triflupromazine, prochlorperazine. Then you have got very important two classes of drugs. These are the prokinetic drugs, metoclopramide, domperidone, mosapride, etopride. And the next one is 5-HT3 receptor antagonist, ondansetron, granisetron, ramosetron, and palonosetron. Then you have got NK1 receptor antagonists like aprepitant and fosaprepitant, and some adjuvant antiemetics like dexamethasone, which is a steroid, benzodiazepines, and cannabinoids. So of all these drugs, the most important or the most significant from the therapeutic use as well as from your examination point of view is the prokinetic drugs and 5-HT3 antagonists. So we will take up these two classes of drugs very elaborately in the part 2 of the antiemetic topic. So in this class, we will be covering the rest of these anti-emetic drugs, that is anticholinergics, antihistaminics, neuroleptics, and the NK1 receptor antagonists and the adjuvant drugs. So we'll be taking them one by one now. So first we'll go to anticholinergics. So the important ones, that is the most popular of the anticholinergics which is used as an antiemetic, is hyoscine. The mechanism of action is very evident. It is blocking the cholinergic conduction from the vestibular apparatus to the VC. So I told you earlier, there is a cholinergic link from the vestibular apparatus in the inner ear to the VC. Now this is being blocked by the hyoscine. So where do you think hyoscine will be used mainly? Hyoscine will be mainly used in the case of motion sickness, for short journeys. Okay, so it is mainly used for motion sickness induced vomiting. So I already know, I hope that you already know what is motion sickness. So whenever we are traveling, okay, some individuals, they have a tendency to get vomiting as well as giddiness. And this is because of the loss in the equilibrium, because of the disturbances in the inner ear. It doesn't happen to everybody. It can occur in certain individuals. And this is mainly because of a cholinergic link from the vestibular apparatus to the vomiting center. Now, when this is blocked, then this can be relieved. So, hyoscine is mainly used for motion sickness. It can be only used for short journeys because the effect doesn't last too long. And one of the main problem with this, or the disadvantage of this drug, is that it can cause a lot of sedation and a sensation of dryness in the mouth because of its anticholinergic action. Okay, other anticholinergic actions, it can cause dry mouth. So how is it administered? It can be either administered orally or intramuscularly, but the most popular route of administration is by a transdermal patch. You can see here, is applied behind the pinna 3 or 4 hours before the starting of the journey, and the effect, the antiemetic effect, lasts for approximately 3 days after with one patch. Then there's another drug called as a dicyclomine, which is another anticholinergic, and this is also used for prophylaxis of motion sickness and morning sickness. So what is morning sickness? It is the early, it is the vomiting associated with the early pregnancy, so early period of pregnancy. So this is the dicyclomine, can be used for motion sickness and also for morning sickness. Now we'll move on to the H1 antihistaminics. So their antiemetic action is based mainly on the antihistaminic property. So I told you H1 receptors are also present in all these relay areas, and by blocking them we can actually decrease the stimulus for vomiting. So H1 antihistaminics, when you were studying about them, you have learned that the first generation H1 antihistaminics, they have got additional anticholinergic activities, and also they are sedative. So all these two actions also contribute to their antiemetic action. Their antiemetic action is mainly because of antihistaminic property, anticholinergic property, as well as sedative properties. So the antihistaminics used are promethazine, diphenhydramine, dimenhydrinate. Now they are mainly used for motion sickness, but again, because of anticholinergic property also, they can produce sedation and dry mouth. They also have got some anti-dopaminergic action, that is mainly seen in the case of promethazine, not with the others. They can only with promethazine, additional anti-dopaminergic action. Meclizine is less sedative and less anticholinergic, and also long-acting when compared to promethazine, diphenhydramine, and dimenhydrinate. So they are mainly used for seasickness. Okay, because their action is long, so they can act for more than 24 hours. So they are used mainly for seasickness treatment or prophylaxis. Doxylamine is very important because it is one of the popular drugs used in combination with pyridoxine for morning sickness in pregnancy. Doxylamine is one of the very preferred antiemetic drug for pregnancy, and it is usually administered along with pyridoxine, and it also has got prominent sedative and anticholinergic actions. So remember, promethazine, diphenhydramine, dimenhydrinate, mainly used for motion sickness, but it has got short action, excessive sedation, and dry mouth. As compared to these, meclizine has less sedative, less anticholinergic, and is longer acting, and therefore it is used for prophylaxis of seasickness. And doxylamine is mainly used for pregnancy-induced morning sickness. Now moving on to neuroleptics. So these are blocking the D2 receptors in the CTZ, and I already have quoted the examples in the classification. So once again, the examples are here. Now, these have got a lot of uses. So they are used for drug-induced and post-operative nausea and vomiting, abbreviated as PONV, disease-induced vomiting because of gastroenteritis, uremia, liver disease, migraine. Okay, these conditions are associated with vomiting. So these drugs can be used for them also. Malignancy-induced vomiting, chemotherapy-induced vomiting, that is CINV, radiation-induced vomiting, RINV. So people who undergo chemotherapy or radiation therapy, they are prone to vomiting because these drugs can cause a lot of vomiting. And I already told you in the introduction, these drugs, they cause the release of mainly serotonin from the enteropromaffin cells of the gut, and also the other mediators, and these can stimulate the CTZ and the NTS and can cause vomiting. Even severe forms of morning sickness, that is hyperemesis gravidarum, can be dealt with them. So we do not usually use them for mild morning sickness. They are only resorted for severe forms of morning sickness, that is hyperemesis gravidarum. Remember that these neuroleptics are not used for motion sickness. So I told you motion sickness, there's a cholinergic link which is causing the motion sickness. Now these drugs do not inhibit the cholinergic link. So hence they do not find any use in the case of motion sickness, but they have got a lot of use in case of PONV, that is post-operative nausea and vomiting, chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting, that is CINV, RINV, that is radiation therapy-induced vomiting, okay, nausea and vomiting. So all these conditions finds a lot of use. But one main disadvantage is that it causes a lot of sedation and can cause a significant muscular dystonia. Now, what are these muscular dystonia? Muscular dystonias are painful contractions and abnormal postures of the body. You can see here, it is a painful contraction of the, you can see here, neck muscles. It's a painful contraction. You can see the child has, the neck is in an abnormal posture. This is called as a dystonia, and this can be seen in children who are treated with neuroleptic drugs. So this is one significant adverse effect of neuroleptic drugs. Then prochlorperazine. So you can see one of the drugs was prochlorperazine, and this has got a very additional labyrinthine suppressant action and has got selective anti-vertigo action. This is the only drug which has got a selective labyrinthine suppressive action. So in the among the neuroleptics, so it can be given for not only vomiting but also for vertigo. Now we go to the neurokinin 1 receptor antagonist. So I told you one of the important receptors present in the CTZ was the NK1 receptor, and it is mainly stimulated by substance P that is released during the chemotherapy and other emetogenic stimuli. And by blocking these receptors, we can actually overcome the chemotherapy-induced vomiting. So these are mainly examples that are prepotent and force are prepotent, and they are mainly used for chemotherapy-induced vomiting. So one example of a drug that is used in chemotherapy is cisplatin, and it can cause very high-grade vomiting. Okay, so this drug, NK1 receptor antagonist, example, a prepotent, is used mainly for cisplatin-induced vomiting. Now we come to the last category of drugs, that is the corticosteroids. So these drugs, under these corticosteroids, the one main drug that is used is dexamethasone, and it is usually given IV for chemotherapy-induced vomiting, and it is used as an add-on drug to the other drugs. So we have seen that many other drugs are also used for chemotherapy-induced vomiting. This is not singly used. It is used only as an add-on drug. So if other drugs are not self-sufficient, or if it is not causing the adequate anti-emesis. So this drug also can be added. Then similarly, benzodiazepine. This is also not used singly. It is also used as an add-on drug to other anti-emetic drugs. And these drugs, they mainly reduce the vomiting tendency because of their sedative action, and also because they can decrease the psychogenic component of vomiting. See, so whenever you have got tendency of vomiting, so you feel that you have a psychogenic drive, okay, because once you vomit, you have tendency to vomit again. So these drugs also cut off the psychogenic component of vomiting, and they are used as add-on to other anti-emetics. Then the last category of drugs for this session are cannabinoids. Example are dronabinol and nabilone. And this is actually, they are tetrahydrocannabinol extracted from cannabis. Okay, cannabis, or it can be produced synthetically also. Again, they are used mainly as for chemotherapy-induced vomiting, only in patients who are not really responding to the other drugs, or in whom the other drugs cannot be used for some reason. So this drug is used or resorted to only those patients. But one main drawback for this drug is that it can cause a sensation of hallucination and disorienting action. Okay, so this is the summary of this class. So we have discussed the anti cholinergic drugs, we have discussed the antihistaminic drugs, then we have discussed the neuroleptic drugs, then we discussed the NK1 receptor antagonists, and the last one, that is corticosteroids like dexamethasone, benzodiazepines, and cannabinoids like dronabinol and nabilone. So this class is to be continued, and we are going to discuss a very important class, which I told you already, that is the prokinetic drugs and the 5-HT3 receptor antagonists in the next session. That is the most important part of this class. So till that, you will revise the first part and be ready for the second session on Saturday. So thank you all for hearing.